Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Neuroscience Grand Rounds with the Pacific Neuroscience Institute in conjunction with Providence Little Company of Mary. We have a unique and exciting talk today, a topic that we haven't really broached in the last 4 or 5 years of doing this. So I'm glad we have Dr. Guan and my friend and co-resident from the University of Utah to join us. Dr. Karsy is an assistant professor of neurosurgery, neuro-oncology, and skull-based surgery at the University of Utah. He treats tumors and vascular pathology through minimally invasive, endoscopic, and traditional open microsurgical approaches. Along with Dr. Guan and myself, he completed his residency at the University of Utah. And following his residency training, he completed a fellowship in minimally invasive and complex spine, as well as getting his master's in bioengineering, specifically for medical device development at the University of Utah. He did his medical school at New York Medical College and did his PhD there as well in his combined MD-PhD program. Following his fellowship in skull-based neuro-oncology at Thomas Jefferson, he returned back to the University of Utah as faculty. His research interests are broad, and I'll tell you, along with Dr. Guan, they're two of the most impressive, productive academicians from a resident and young neurosurgeon perspective that I've come in contact with. I've met quite a few people who've come up through the millennial residency course, and these guys really buck the trend and stand apart. He focuses mostly on healthcare outcomes, novel surgical approaches, and the better molecular characterizations of tumors. And in doing so, he's amassed approximately 150 publications, 12 book chapters, including and even a surgical textbook. Incredibly impressive statistics for a young surgeon, but I'm more impressed by his very conscientious and caring patient care that I watched him exhibit all the way from his time as an intern at the University of Utah, and I think is going to continue throughout a very productive and successful academic career. So Dr. Karsy, with that, the floor is yours. Thanks again.
Thank you, Dr. Sivakumar, for the kind introduction. It's a pleasure being here and being amongst you guys and seeing some familiar faces and some new faces. And I've heard just great things about the PNI program, talking to Dr. Guan and Dr. Sivakumar. So you guys really have just an impressive group. I thought maybe we could talk a little bit about traumatic brain injury today. I think that, certainly there are many other topics we talk about. I do a lot of neuro-oncology as well, but one thing that touches, I think, everyone in this audience is trauma. And I thought maybe it'd be time to talk a little bit about what the sort of updates in trauma look like right now, and maybe some novel ideas kind of preliminarily in how they're being explored, and see what you guys think about it. These are some of my disclosures. Two of the studies that we're going to talk about, I'm a co-investigator on. I don't get any funding for it. It's just they do help some of the study coordinators for allowing us to input data. And I thought we could talk a little bit about TBI epidemiology and mechanisms, basically as an introduction and sort of review as to some of the pathophysiology and some of the new things that are being learned about TBI, as well as some of the guidelines and updates to those guidelines and some new ideas in TBI and some of the clinical trials that are currently being done in traumatic brain injury and other topics. So briefly about traumatic brain injury, it is extremely common. 2 to 3 million injuries occur annually. You have about 50 to 60,000 deaths annually in the U.S. The most common reasons are from falls, firearms, motor vehicle collisions, and they peak in the youth with trauma and violence in the youth, and they peak in the elderly with regards to falls. The pathophysiology of TBI really involved primary and secondary injury. So primary injury kind of involves the insult, the mechanical injury, the bleeding that occurs after an event, and the secondary injury results in the hypoxemia, the glutamate upregulation, all these sort of molecular changes that occur that can continue to cause injury to a patient. And that's kind of where neurosurgeons and neurocritical care providers really become important in trying to prevent that secondary injury from causing more harm. So there's many different types of TBI bleed patterns. This is just a review of them, of different locations that you can have bleeding. And these are associated with different outcomes as well as different strategies for management. And the molecular mechanism, as we sort of alluded to, is complex. So here's just a simplified review of kind of the molecular mechanisms where you have activation of microglia, disruption of the blood-brain barrier, infiltration of immune cells, upregulation of inflammatory cytokines and chemokines, where those can cause disruption of neurons as well as astrocytes, upregulation of glutamate, calcium that causes abnormal downstream regulation of signaling pathways that can result in cell apoptosis and necrosis. This is not just, you know, a head injury and you have kind of the result of it, but these molecular processes impact the recovery of a patient. Just as a brief overview, I'm not sure kind of the level of all the different members of this audience, but just to go over a little bit of kind of how do you manage a patient with TBI? It's the same with every patient that comes in. It's a trauma patient. You assess your ABCs, airway breathing circulation, assess the GCS or Glasgow Coma Scale so you can objectively discuss that with other providers and kind of have an assessment hour by hour how a patient is doing. Look at pupil reactivity, cough, gag, corneals, brainstem reflexes, essentially. And then also look at other medical issues. Is there alcohol or drug use on board that's confounding your results? Is there sedation? Is there anticoagulation that could result in a bleed worsening potentially? What was the mechanism of injury? Was it high velocity, low velocity? Our typical go-to and most standard community and academic centers are CT scans and CTA scans. CTA is really just to look at vascular injury if indicated. It's not used on every patient. And MRI is typically not used in an acute fashion, but could be used to look for diffuse axonal injury and other issues afterwards. Some of the things you could rapidly do for a patient is elevate their head. That's been shown to be safe. Even if a patient has spine precautions, you can tilt the whole bed just to get, you know, reduced intracranial pressure. That's a very easy thing to do, commonly overlooked. Hyperventilation is very transiently used. It's only if patients are having acute decline that you're trying to go to the OR because it can result in ischemia if you keep it for prolonged periods of time. The literature has talked about seizure prophylaxis for approximately a week and moderate to severe TBI, and that continues to really be the best evidence we have. A lot of times, people will be on anti-seizure medications for longer, but really the best level evidence really talks only about a week of treatment. Hyperosmolar therapy and other interventions to help reduce intracranial pressure. Those I will talk a little about some of the studies where people were using that expectedly, basically without an ICP monitor, as well as typically in modern American hospitals, we'll have some sort of pressure monitor where you can use that to titrate osmolar therapy and other treatments. A medically induced coma and therapeutic cooling. Coma is certainly a last resort. We'll talk a little bit about the hierarchy of tiered interventions to reduce intracranial pressure. And therapeutic cooling is really less favored now than it has been before. It doesn't have the same benefits as, say, in cardiac conditions where you have brain protection. Really, it has more adverse effects in neurosurgical patients. So here's some brief ways that people have described different levels of traumatic brain injury into mild, moderate, and severe. These are somewhat arbitrary, but they do help to discuss amongst different colleagues what kind of level of severity a patient is. Typically, the GCS is the best way to describe this, 13 to 15 being mild, 9 to 12 being moderate, and less than 8 being a severe TBI. And there's various different grading systems for clinical assessment of the severity of a TBI. One of the classic ways that the imaging has been looked at to describe the severity of a TBI is the Marshall classification shown here, and essentially breaks down into different categories where the highest category, typically 1 through 4, because surgically removed lesions like 5 and 6 are kind of a different thing, but Marshall class 1 through 4 does correlate in study after study with worsened outcomes. So this consistently has been shown to be really important as a way of kind of looking at how bad a scan is and how bad a patient's doing. The typical indications for an ICP monitor are patients with a GCS between 3 to 8 and an abnormal CT scan, typically blood in the head or mass occupying effect. this other criteria in the TBI guidelines with patients being greater than 40 unilateral or bilateral posturing or SPP less than 90. This was brought from one specific study where this was used as inclusion criteria for MODERATOR. And so that has been sort of a second indication for MODERATORs in patients in the current TBI guidelines. The indications for decompressive hemicraniectomy are very variable depending on patient selection. Typically, most of the studies talk about what factors sort of portend to poor outcomes in these patients. And then so you know kind of if a hematoma is greater than 1 centimeter or there's midline shift greater than 5 millimeter, those patients tend to do worse. So they become the metrics for when you decide on a decompressive hemicraniectomy. But we'll talk about some of the studies that have other indications as well. Certainly declining GCS or ICPs that aren't managed by medical means alone or other indications as well. But this is a very nuanced sort of thing that requires a lot of insight and sort of experience and kind of knowing when's the right time to decompress them or not. Various neuroprotection strategies that have been tried, but unfortunately haven't been very successful in protecting patients from improving outcomes are shown here. Patients have also, researchers also talked about neurorestoration, whether you could use stem cell therapy for restoring function after TBI. And certainly this has been done in animal models, but nothing clinically. And neurorehabilitation continues to be an evolving field where many emerging studies start to talk about the role of rehabilitation and objectively improving outcome, what that does to resting state fMRI studies, connectivity. All those are kind of interesting topics that are still active areas of research. So certainly there's a lot to learn about how the brain recovers from TBI. So let's talk about the TBI guidelines. These are the fourth edition guidelines published in 2016 and the various topics that were discussed within them. Most of the recommendations in here are sort of grade two and level two, level three evidence, not really great studies, not a lot of randomized trials, many single center studies help to guide the current management of patients, as well as just experience and learning about how sort of what works over time. So these are the different categories, and I encourage you, if you haven't looked at these already, I think they're pretty straightforward to look through and kind of see what the guidelines are. I mostly wanted to talk about a couple of new studies. So in that fourth edition of TBI guidelines, a couple of the studies had not been included that we're going to talk about now. One was called the DECRA study. This is a randomized clinical trial looking at 155 patients with severe diffuse TBI and moderate ICP. It was an international study. And this study randomized patients to receive a decompressive bifrontal hemicraniectomy or craniectomy versus medical care alone. Patients were randomized within 72 hours if they had elevated ICPs. And noted that's really important here is that they were unresponsive to first-tier ICP intervention. So basically, they took these patients, if they kind of weren't responding to like the basic ICP managements, they were randomized to decompression or medical management. The outcomes for this study showed that mortality was the same and that the outcome scores are actually worse in the surgical category, suggesting that surgery harmed these patients. But these differences were decreased after we adjusted for pupil reactivity, some secondary analysis. One of the main criticisms of this paper is that they really waited quite a bit of time to be able to use this intervention. And then this group really only used first tier ICP interventions. They didn't really go on to the second and third tier interventions, which a lot of the guidelines talk about now. So those are the sort of criticisms of this particular study. Another really important study was called the Rescue ICP. This is published in New England Journal. It was 408 patients with severe refractory post-traumatic ICP elevation. It was a multi-center international study. These patients were randomized to a decompression or medical therapy if ICPs were greater than 25 for 1 hour and not responsive to first or second tier interventions. So again, this was kind of important for knowing that they were using more aggressive medical management than the DECRA study. The one criticism of this study was that there was crossover. There were patients in the medical randomized group that probably had ICP problems and were randomized to decompression. So it wasn't a pure study, but it was a really important study. As I said, there's not a lot of level one studies in this category, in this field. And the results did show lower mortality with decompression, but much higher rates of vegetative and disabled states at 6 months. This was the primary outcome of the study. And then they had improvement in overall 12-month favorable Glasgow outcome scores at 12 months. That was a secondary outcome of the study. So overall, this study does support the role of decompressive hemicraniectomy in well-selected patients, but also sort of opens the idea that, you know, some of these patients are going to become vegetative or disabled as well. So, you know, better prediction of which one of those patients are going to be like that would be helpful. Certainly there's more to learn from this, but this was some evidence supportive of surgery for the right patient. This is another study talked about in the literature, but the results are not really out for this. It's a randomized multi-center study looking at decompression and bone removal or decompression alone for acute subdural hematoma. Again, results are not out yet, publicly, so I can't really talk about what that shows just yet. And this is another study looking at basically, this is an international study by the Global Neurotrauma Research Group, 324 patients. Patients were randomized to ICP monitoring versus expected management. Basically, they were given tier one medications for ICP management without a monitor. This is a kind of study that when we talk about it, can only kind of be done outside of America because the standard of care for patients who have severe TBI is placement of ICP monitor. You couldn't really randomize them to just not have a monitor, if that makes sense. But what this study did show was that a 24-1 measure composite functional score was the same between the two groups. 6-month mortality was the same. ICU staying was the same. So essentially, in situations where you have mass occupying lesions or someone has a severe TBI, you can initiate potentially the beginning tier one kind of ICP management strategies. There wasn't worsened adverse effects with those treatments, according to this study, and potentially buy some time. Obviously in America, you're gonna put an ICP monitor in, but you may be in situations where you don't have an ICP monitor or it's not working, or you're transiting a patient from the field to a hospital. So this study supports it. Early interventions can be helpful. The one caveat with this study is that the group that was essentially blinded and didn't have an ICP monitor, they had higher use of hyperosmolar therapy and hyperventilation. So it suggests that if you don't have that monitor, you don't have the ability to titrate your medications very well. You're just kind of throwing them in and hoping that it's working a little bit. So certainly I think there's a role for monitoring, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. So based on those studies, the TBI guidelines basically had this 2020 updated recommendations showing that secondary decompressive hemicraniectomy is recommended for late refractory ICP elevations and not for early refractory ICP elevations. So again, just, I don't know if this really changed a lot of what most neurosurgeons were doing, but it did sort of add more data to what we were kind of thinking about. And another more recent study talked about all the data and reorganized it in terms of different categories and sort of talking about the role of decompressive hemicraniectomy and have these different sections that sort of talk about what's the best available evidence. So, if you're more interested in this topic, this is definitely something to look at. Here's some novel topics I kind of came across as I was sort of preparing for this talk and kind of thinking about, well, what's new in trauma? Well, what are things that we're looking at? And really from a surgical standpoint, that's kind of what I do mostly. So, hinge cranioplasties have been something that have been described in the literature for some time. This is the idea that you could potentially remove a bone flap but place it in such a way that you allow decompression. And then as that patient's swelling reduces, the bone flaps reduces back into position, avoiding another surgery. And cranioplasty procedures, from the time the patient has a decompression to cranioplasty, I typically quote them about a 30% risk of some sort of complication. It could be mild or significant, but it is not a benign procedure at all to do a decompressive hemicraniectomy. And even to do the cranioplasty, it has complications. So this is an idea of, could we reduce that into one step? And there are a couple of studies that recently talk about this. That's why I thought we could discuss it a little bit. This one study in 2016 talked about 57 patients that underwent a decompressive hemicraniectomy with the hinge cranioplasty using vicryl suture. They showed that you had meaningful improvement in ICP scores from 32 pre-op to 15 post-op, improvement of midline shift. About 7 out of these 50 some patients returned to the OR for some unrelated surgery. And then 44 out of the 57 patients sort of survived after this. So it suggested that this is possible. It suggested that these patients weren't bouncing back to the OR to get the bone flap completely removed. And so there was a potential role for this. I think overall, I should say, to make one point on this, I think if you go back to some of the updates on decompressive hemicraniectomy that the guidelines have talked about, there really still isn't sufficient data to support the use of this. This is sort of still kind of more in the limited levels of evidence for support based on what's available. Another topic that's been discussed is basal cisternotomy, basically a mechanism of improving cisternal drainage, opening up membranes around the optic nerve or various skull-based triangles. Certainly this is treacherous to do in a patient who's having a decompressive surgery. I mean, it adds time to your surgery. The brain is swollen and you're trying to retract it to get down to the basal cisterns, but it's something that's been discussed. It first was discussed in 2019 and continues to be something that has interest. And one of the hypotheses for why this is important isn't simply just removal of CSF and creating more space, but it's this idea that the brain's glymphatic system is disrupted after TBI. And that may be a mechanism for why you're getting such significant cerebral edema. And by placing a drain in the cisterns, that may increase and improve the ability of the glymphatic system to drain out fluid from the brain in a way that it can't do after TBI. And so there are some theories as to whether this could be beneficial in TBI patients. Again, the data to support this is very limited, but it is an interesting topic. I think it needs a lot more animal research to be able to better understand. And then maybe even think about medical treatments that can try to do some of this glymphatic drainage modulation rather than this kind of a surgical procedure. So this study basically looked at 50 patients with severe TBI and randomized them to decompression versus a cisternotomy procedure. Similar reductions in ICP were seen. A reduced mechanical ventilation was seen in the cisternotomy group along with reduced ICU length of stay, but the outcomes were ultimately the same after this is all done. So Still more work needs to be done on this. Another study looked at 40 patients, basically looked at cisternotomy versus those that had cisternotomy plus decompression and didn't show a difference between the two groups. So limited sample sizes, needs a lot more work. To pivot a little bit to a little bit of a different topic, but still kind of related to TBI, chronic subdural, something we commonly see, very common neurosurgical procedure. A lot of times these can also form after acute subdural hematomas. I've had patients with small trivial acute subdural hematomas that come back in a month and they have large chronic subdurals that have formed that need surgical treatment. So this fits into trauma quite a bit. The incidence is fairly common. Patients present with cognitive and neurological changes. These are more common in the elderly population. The mortality can be very high in some series. Some have described the mortality as high as 30%, probably in the older literature rather than the modern literature, but still it's significant. The recurrence rate is a big problem with these. About 20 to 30% of these can recur. And the reason for that is that it's more complex than just bleeding that's happened. There is a complex hypoxic inflammatory signaling cascade kind of shown here in that cartoon, which implicates multiple molecular pathways and a mechanism. And this isn't shown in animal models as well as by looking at some of these proteins in these patients. So the complex mechanism and why and how we're not able to stop that mechanism is probably one of the main reasons why this recurrence occurs. So one of the thoughts that we had with this was whether we could use endoscopic assisted subdural hematoma evacuation. We're not the first to suggest this, but we are looking at this in a more modern series with modern 4K endoscopes and modern equipment in a way that didn't exist before. Basically, the idea is to do a mini craniectomy, a craniotomy, similar to what we'd be doing evacuating these hematomas anyways, but also using the endoscope to see if we can add benefit to these patients. This is sort of our summary of 9 patients. We've done this in about 20 patients so far, only one recurrence early in our series, and we become more aggressive in how we sort of cauterize membranes and cauterize leaky areas and get hemostasis after surgery. We found that we can really take down friable membranes. We can get greater clot evacuation. We can cauterize areas that are oozy. We can get hemostasis of bridging veins. We can view the brain and make sure that our evacuation or placement of drains isn't injuring any brain. Certainly, there's some limitations. You have to have a decent size space between the brain and the skull to be able to do this. This is just one case example of that. This is a 79-year-old gentleman. Again, this guy presented with acute small subdurals that went away for a month and came back with these bilateral giant subdurals. And after evacuation of the hematoma, you know, with tons of normal saline, this is the amount of clot that remained. So there's still a significant amount that was there. And this is early in our series, and I think we would have probably been more aggressive in evacuating hematoma now compared to this point. But you can see how we use this malleable suction to carefully visualize what we're doing. There's no force, there's no aggressive moves. Here we can identify a stretched cortical vein that could be at risk of bleeding if we were to just leave the patient. We can cauterize leaky membranes using, this is a suction bovie, so it can actually allow electrical current to cauterize areas that we think could cause bleeding later. And you can see where, you know, the brain and the skull are kind of attached, where you basically, and this is run, this video is at 2x speed. So if it looks like there's like a rabbit operating, it's because the video is running fast. But this is sort of what it looked like. There was a little bit of post-operative bleeding that you can see. I'll be very honest about that. And I was kind of concerned, but over time that really improved. And you can see this improvement, and the patient clinically did really well also after this. So potentially there's a role in that. There needs to be more work to look at it and look at outcomes. And we did a systematic review where we looked at 14 studies that had used endoscope assisted evacuations. We found that the recurrence rate varied from about 0 to 8.8%. Already, this is better than the literature with burr holes and burr holes plus drains, which was about 20-30% recurrence. So there may be something here. Certainly, there's a lot of variation in the literature on techniques and how people use the endoscope. There's also a lot of other variables. You know, currently we're using middle meningeal artery embolization, which we'll talk about. People describe various levels of membrane resection, which is still very controversial for these groups of patients. So I think we just need more studies. Dr. Sivakumar and I have talked about this topic and potentially collaborating and sharing some of our data together to be able to better understand whether this could be something useful to look at. One of the more recent studies that came out with TBI is the CRASH-3 study, published in 2019, and then a follow-up study was done in 2021, secondary analysis, looking at the role of TXA, or transeximic acid, basically a fibrin degradation product inhibitor by the mechanism of sort of preventing plasminogen from forming plasmin. This is a randomized clinical trial in TBI patients with moderate to severe TBI, given TXA 1 gram over 10 minutes and then 1 gram over 8 hours versus placebo. It involved 12,000 patients. Overall, they showed that there were no significant changes in injury or risk of injury in different levels of TBI. There was a risk of reduced death in patients with mild TBI, but not severe TBI. I think what was most interesting about this study, though, was the secondary analysis, showing that you could reduce hemorrhagic expansion in patients. Now, for a drug that had no significant adverse events, that's been shown to be really effective in polytrauma and scoliosis deformity, as well as liver resection, liver surgeries, TXA could easily be used in our TBI literature. It's something we commonly, you know, don't think about, because it's just not part of the guidelines yet and not commonly discussed, but it has some evidence that it could at least be helpful for reducing hematoma expansion. Whether there's a role in patients who are on anticoagulants, there could be some additional study there, but it's really unclear at this point. But it's something that I think this audience that treats TBI patients can think about a little bit more. To pivot a little bit more into a different novel topic with application TBI, one of the areas of work that we're looking at is on augmented reality. And basically this is the ability to add additional information onto your visual, onto your eyes to be able to, you know, map patient images, to be able to use that information to treat patients. So this is very different from virtual reality, where you basically completely occlude your vision. You can't really use that in surgery or medical treatment, but you can use augmented reality for both pre-planning of surgery as well as actually using it during surgery. Most of the literature talks about applications in cranial surgery and spine and education, and there's not really a role yet for it in trauma, but I think there's a lot of potential. I'll talk about a study that we looked at. Basically AR could be used for surgical planning. It allows for more intuitive understanding of the lesion location. So for residents and fellows that are learning how to operate, and this can be used for tumors and other kinds of things too, but even things as simple as locating a subdural hematoma, augmented reality might be able to allow a trainee to better understand where that lesion is in a better way than current measurements or navigation. You can add different modalities onto it. So basically any kind of DICOM can be added onto this. It allows you to then record video. It allows you to stream video. There's a lot of potential there for teaching or for helping with remote sort of training and oversight. So say you have providers in different states, or even the military has a lot of interest in this as well, whether someone's in the field and is using this to better assess a patient or to give information back to a team back at a home base to be able to help a patient. There's a lot of potential for this. So we collaborate with a group called Novarad. They're a company out here in Utah that have a software platform built onto Microsoft HoloLens 2. Allows you to basically upload any kind of DICOM image you want. This is some cadaveric work they were doing looking at ventricles and sort of seeing how accurate the ventricles are and whether you could target them. And we did a study in collaboration with them where we basically use phantoms and a cadaver to place EVDs, basically external ventricular drains used for treatment of intracranial pressure. These are commonly used in trauma, but they are used in other types of indications as well. So we use two phantoms to basically understand what the accuracy of the system is. One was using CT guided measurements, Phantom 1, and one was using Axiom, basically Medtronic's navigation system. And then we also use a cadaver model. So when our best model using CT to CT guided measurements with trained professionals kind of who know how to use this technology, we showed that we could get an accuracy of under 1 millimeter in targeting the ventricle, basically going from skin to ventricle using just this Novarad Visar system alone. And then we also looked at a variety of different trainees. Again, this is using Axiom, so it's a little bit different measurement because you're doing this in a different setting, you're doing this with residents. But what we did show with this is that the residents and medical students that did this, some with very limited experience on placing EVDs, were doing as well as attendings or chief residents with plenty of experience. We had a mean error of about 4 millimeters. And there was no difference based on PGY level, previous experience with AR or EVDs, video games, anything like that. There was some improvement over time, as you can see with figures F and G on how accurate these people were, but again, that didn't reach any significance. And this is a basically a comparison of different PGY levels. These are two of our residents doing a frontal and occipital EVD using just the Visar system. This Axiom system was used to sort of internally verify how accurate they were. Again, no difference based on PGY level. Then we also looked at whether traditional anatomical targeting versus using the Visar system was beneficial. So traditional anatomical targeting showed a accuracy of about 1 centimeter. That's me speaking. About 1 centimeter. And once you use the Visar system, you're getting down to about 4 millimeters consistently. So there's a significant improvement in distance and angular error with different trajectories when using a Visar system. And I think this could be helpful for patients, for providers who maybe are in community hospitals that don't have a neurosurgeon or in the field and they need to get drains in the patients or any other kind of situation you can you can think of where you need to have more intuitive understanding of anatomy. These are some other, I call them the weird EVD trajectories. These are sort of non-traditional EVD trajectories that are typically very difficult to do because they require angulation and all these measurements. But with this Visar system, you can easily do these really non-traditional EVD techniques. You don't have to use landmarks to be able to do so. And the last topic I wanted to talk about is about novel clinical trials and TBI. Basically, we're part of the TRAC TBI research group. These are a group of multi-center academic and other types of institutions around the country who are interested in traumatic brain injury. And there are various phases of the TRAC TBI investigation. The host institution has been UCSF with a significant interest in TBI going back. And over time, from the TRAC TBI pilot study all the way through the different variations and other trials, there have been many different specific clinical trials and registries developed with this consortium. And so some of the earliest studies with TRAC TBI looked at just the registry of patients entered into it. This was looking at mild TBI patients, basically 1,453 patients with mild TBI, basically tracking kind of what the time of recovery was for these patients. It did show that 93% of these patients showed some sort of functional limitation about 2 weeks, and that 53% showed some limitation at 12 months. I think for anyone who's actually treated TBI, I think these numbers are a little bit alarming. You know, most of your patients basically 2 weeks after a mild injury are going to still have some sort of problems, and only half of them are going to recover about a year out. I think this can be quite life-altering for patients. And these are patients that may not have any bleed, they may not have any surgery, they might not have even lost any consciousness with their injury, and can have a life-altering effect for them. Certainly patients that had imaging findings showed a significant difference in how long it took for them to recover or if they ever recovered. And you can see this comparison of patients with orthopedic injury and mild TBI showing that the orthopedic injuries were some sort of control group for this initial registry, basically showing kind of a comparison of how the recovery kind of looks like over time. Another follow-up to their study was looking at moderate to severe TBI. This registry component involved 362 patients with severe TBI, 122 with moderate TBI, recently published, showing that 12% of severe TBIs and 41% of moderate TBIs showed a favorable outcome at 2 weeks, which is poor. You know, you see a patient with severe TBI and the family's asking how's this patient going to do? Well, not well at 2 weeks, but surprisingly, 50% of patients with severe TBI and 75% of moderate TBI showed favorable outcome at 1 year. And that's I think really important to tell a family that, hey, you have a patient with severe TBI, they're going to look pretty bad at 2 weeks, but they could potentially show improvement at 1 year. Now, we don't have enough information to predict which one of those patients with severe TBI, because there is heterogeneity to that group. We can't predict which ones are going to actually look better in a year. But I think this data does offer quite a bit of hope to patients, especially in their families when they come in and they're asking, so what's my loved one going to look like a year out? So I think this is a really interesting study and really something that a registry can answer that's going to get multiple centers and different mechanisms of injury and different types of populations and really show that there's what the potential recovery is going to look like. One of the other studies that's really exciting in the field of TBI is the idea of Lykox monitoring. Basically, Lykox is a oxygen monitoring system. Bolts and things like that measure ICP. Lykox measures actual brain oxygenation. So the Boost 2 trial was a study of 119 patients with severe TBI randomized to receive ICP monitoring versus ICP plus Lykox monitoring. Basically, they showed that patients with the Lykox monitor had a significant reduction in hypoxia time. There were no adverse events from the monitors, but they didn't really improve outcome. The Glasgow coma scale did not show a significant difference between the patients with Lykox versus Lykox plus ICP monitoring, but the study was really not powered to show that kind of difference. And so I wouldn't criticize the study just yet. I think that it was just underpowered for that kind of outcome. And there is still some role for Lykox monitoring. I think that sort of brings us to the concept of the Boost 3 trial. So this is a planned, well-powered study to be able to answer this question, whether ICP versus ICP plus Lykox improves outcomes in patients with severe TBI. And we enroll patients in this trial and we use Lykox, and basically you're completely blinded to the Lykox numbers if you're in that arm. You can't see the numbers. You only see your ICP numbers. All the continuous data is tracked on the patients. There's loads of data that are captured about the pattern of injury, the type of hemorrhage. When do you administer tier one, tier two, tier three medications? How many of these patients go off to surgery? There is a lot of data being generated right now with these patients to be able to help answer this question. What's also really interesting about this study is that they looked at different prescribed treatments based on ICP and Likox monitoring. The goal is to basically maintain ICP below 22 and PVO2 or oxygenation above 20. And there's various, prescribed here, if your patient's in this category, do this. It's very, very specific, which is nice because a lot of times our criticism with the Likox monitor has been kind of, what do we do with this data? How do we improve a patient's outcome? What kind of interventions can we do? And this study is helping to kind of answer that question. Then the primary outcome is actually quite nice. Glasgow outcome coma scale at 180 days by blinded central examiner. I think this is, once this study is done, it's going to play a huge role in kind of our management of TBI, regardless of what it shows. This is an example of kind of the ABCD, two by two table of where patients might lie, depending on their different monitoring scenarios and a list. This is just scenario B, showing kind of tier one, tier two, and tier three interventions, talking about the order or no order of what you can use. And I think this is kind of a well-described study and I think will be helpful. Another clinical trial I wanted to briefly talk about involves the role of MMA or middle meningeal artery embolization in the treatment of subdural hematomas. Basically, this is a technique that was described in the 90s, looking at whether you could inject glue or particulate matter to embolize the middle meningeal artery and help reduce the mechanism of acute and chronic subdural hematomas. I think probably in acute subdural hematomas, this might be a little bit less commonly used because those acute hematomas might be having more pressure on the brain. But for chronic subdural hematomas, I think there's a real question as to whether this could be effective in reducing recurrence rate. Remember, we said recurrence rate was 20-30%. Well, several meta-analyses looking at MMA embolization talk about a recurrence rate about 2-4%. So there's some real interest in whether this can reduce morbidity for these patients. There is some important caveats with doing this. There are anastomoses between the middle meningeal artery here and then arteries to the ophthalmic artery, as well as anastomoses to the facial nerve. So facial paralysis and blindness have been reported with this procedure, but I think as we become more comfortable with it and knowing this anatomy better, this has become a safer and safer procedure. So this is a group that basically a multi-center group with some of our colleagues here at the University of Utah and other centers looking at 121 patients that underwent MMA embolization. It's a heterogeneous group of patients that underwent surgery plus or minus MMA, so it's not perfect, but they did show stable to improved imaging in over 97% of patients. There's no control for this group. This is just kind of a prospective, or it was a retrospective, aggregation of patients, but again, showed some of our own data suggesting that there's some potential benefit with doing MMA embolization. The advantages are that many times it can be done under local anesthesia. For patients that may not need a subdural hematoma evacuation, perhaps you can avoid the need for them to go to the OR. The procedure time for MMA embo is much shorter. They don't need drains. They don't need to be in the hospital. The infection risk is much, much lower than an open surgical procedure. So there's lots of advantages potentially, but there's also things that it can't fix. Like it can't fix and address mass effect. And a patient like this with a acute and chronic subdural hematoma, you're going to have to treat this surgically still. There's a trial ongoing right now called the Embolize trial. This is funded by Medtronic. There are multiple other trials that kind of fund, that are funding use of PVA and other kind of devices to help with this embolization. So there's multiple open trials right now looking at this. And Embolize is a multi-center randomized clinical trial looking to randomize patients to embolization or control for subacute or chronic subdural hematoma, with the primary outcome really being recurrence. That's kind of the question we're asking with this. And so patients are, and they come into a trial, they meet inclusion criteria. If you're going to take a patient to surgery, You take them to surgery and then you randomize them afterwards to receive nothing or to receive the embolization. And if they're under observation, same thing, randomized to be control or embolization. So I think a very pragmatic trial with how these patients are going to be managed in the future. And I think this, once the data for this is out, this will be helpful to really better understand whether this embolization works for treating these patients. From our group, we basically have really expanded our TBI and vascular clinical research. We only had one study back in 2018, 2019. These slides are taken from my colleague, Dr. Ramesh Grandi, who does a lot of this work and is kind of the PI on many of these projects. And over that time up to recently, we've expanded the number of trials we're involved with, our coordinators, the research infrastructure, as well as a number of faculty that are involved with this. And so here's a graphic of how our trials are looking right now. I didn't talk about some of these other studies we're involved with, TBI long and ISTAT, but those are other TBI types of clinical trials that are really interesting. Here's a picture of our TBI faculty, as well as our research group, as well as our current residents who are really important with management of these patients, just as probably many of your mid-levels and many of your trainees and fellows are as well. It takes a big team of people. Definitely wanted to thank Dr. Sivakumar and Dr. Guan. This is what they looked like when they were back in 2013 when I started training with them. And thanks to our team, many, many people that are involved with this. There's a lot of funding that's going into these studies on a national basis. You know, very much partner with industry to better understand how we can treat patients better. So a lot of people are involved. And thank you all very much for your attention.
Michael, that was fantastic. That was absolutely fantastic. I'm going to need to get that suction and flexible suction and Bovi thing for me when we get out of this.
Yeah.
Dr. Guan is going to address the questions that have come up. Please type them into the Q&A folder.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. That was great. We'll do some questions here. Dr. Armato has a question. Given the growing interest in recreational MMA and extreme sports training, is there potential for tracking salivary microRNAs, S100B, extracellular vesicles as an indicator for subclinical asymptomatic TBI?
No, that's a great question. One of our, Dr. Grandi, who I mentioned previously, I mean, he's collaborated with some of our molecular biologists here, basically taking some of that subdural fluid and looking for those inflammatory markers. I think the mechanism, as we saw in that cartoon, is complex. So you have to first identify which marker you're going to be looking at that's specific enough to look at and that tracks with outcome. But absolutely, I think cell-free DNA, non-invasive biomarkers, that is definitely the way to go. There was one study that looked at MRI. We typically don't use MRI imaging for looking at subdural hematomas, but had looked at the T2 signal and flare signals on these patients to help predict whether you could predict recurrence, and showed that elevated T2 hyperintensity predicted a lower risk of, or sorry, higher risk of recurrence. So, maybe those patients sort of are favored for embolization or more aggressive screening. So there's various non-invasive biomarkers and imaging platforms that I think would be really interesting for tracking these patients and getting interventions a little bit more nuanced. It's a great question.
I guess one question I had, looking at this, we're obviously part of the embolize as well, and we're doing, this pretty regularly even before we're enrolled. Is the thought in terms of management that chronic subdurals and acute subdurals are just completely different pathology, or is it something where do you think we're ever going to have patients who are sort of on that borderline, they have like an acute subdural that's 8 millimeters in thickness or neurologically intact? Do you think those patients are ever going to be people that we try and embolize? Or do you think it's a sort of a separate pathology?
No, it's a great question. I think everyone here has definitely had patients with sliver-like acute subdurals that convert to chronic for some reason. We don't know why. The people that were using embolization early on in the 90s were looking at acute subdurals, and we're trying to make the argument that there was a role in acute subdurals that you didn't, you weren't going to operate on, that you were going to observe. But again, I think that the data is limited. Those are selected patients. Those are, you'd have to have better criteria for who you operate on, who you're going to embolize. But I think it's probably part of a spectrum. Honestly, I think the mechanisms that cause these subdurals, that the subdural causes that inflammatory hypoxic effect, I think that's going to be there. And the acute subdural initiates that mechanism, I bet you, and then it just sort of ramps up and causes the chronic to occur. So I think they're along the same spectrum.
Another one from Sherry here. Is there a role for dexamethasone and atorvastatin in reducing hematoma and improving neurological function in patients with chronic subdural hematoma?
That's a great question. I use those all the time. I just throw the kitchen sink at my patients, and there are two clinical trials looking at that. One, the atorvastatin trial probably has a little bit better data than the steroid trial. There was also a recent randomized trial looking at post-operative 2 weeks dexamethasone in patients with chronic subdurals. This is the British research consortium that did that, published in New England Journal, that didn't show an improvement with post-operative steroids. So there's mixed data, I think, for the steroids a little bit, but I think that because the recurrence rate is such a problem, I'm typically throwing both those medications at my patients. We put patients on steroids for far less. If we can help to reduce the risk of recurrence, I think it's worth it. You know, I'm typically doing a week of steroids at a very low dose or solumetrol dose pack. I'm not sure what others are doing, but I think there's unclear data whether it perfectly works or not. But
yeah, I think I put almost all my patients on statin. Just because I think it's a relatively benign indication. I think that randomized control trial was pretty convincing. Yeah. I mean, my approach to steroids is pretty similar to yours, Mike. I think that, you hear about steroids for spinal cord injury all the time, right? And you obviously have a lot of studies that have shown that the benefit of that is pretty marginal. But, I think that some of the people that we both obviously train under, they would put them on it. And the idea was, if they don't have a lot of risk factors for infection, like they're not, compromised, if they don't have like a lot of open polytraumatic wounds, then, they're otherwise young and healthy. What are you really losing with doing a short course of, relatively low dose steroids? And the benefit might just be something where, it could be marginal, but, your risks are also pretty marginal. So I think there's a pretty large population where we use it, even if the evidence is a little bit shakier than for some of the other things.
Yeah.
We have seven neurosurgeons in our group, and I think we have like five different sets of practices for these. It's incredible how variable it is.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, we're having a harder time recently during the embolization. I don't know if it's just because of word of mouth. When they start looking up, when we discuss the trial and the families are discussing it, there's a fair amount of trepidation. Jian can speak to it too, about potentially not getting the MMA embo.
Yeah.
I have a feeling that's going to be the popular choice here just because of all the positive early results.
Yeah,
I think it's one of those studies where, you sort of have a point in time where you can really do this study before you're going to, no longer be on the right side of having equipoise for doing it. So,
yeah, we've had problems too with patients on this trial, basically thinking, why is this experimental? Why are you doing this? And we basically have the TBI attending really discuss that right off the bat when they're talking about treatment options. So the patients don't think this is an experiment, but they understand this is part of the treatment, but we need better data to understand it. We explain also at our shop that we were doing MMA embolization for years prior to this trial with that kind of poor level 2, level 3 data. This is a pause to try to get better data, but the level 2 data was compelling, 4% or less recurrence rate, but we need level 1 data really to justify this. And there are risks. Blindness is a risk. Facial recalls, those are real risks with this. Vascular injury. And we're doing subdurals on elderly patients. Typically they have tortuous vessels, atherosclerosis. It's not a straight shot all the time.
Yeah, I think we probably have about 18 months to 2 years to get this trial done.
Yeah.
Or we're gonna have this issue where everybody wants this thing.
Yeah.
I believe that's all the questions. If anybody wants to raise their hand and ask a question, in the meantime, as we mentioned, Mike, that was fantastic. Impressive research, impressive presentation as always. So happy with how far you come and really, really looking forward to how far you go. Thanks again.
Thank you very much. I'm looking forward to collaborating with you guys and working on different projects and talking more. So yeah, email me if you have any questions, certainly.
We'll go ahead, and if anybody wants to copy the slides, it looks like there were a few questions, please go ahead and contact us and we will send out the slides. Dr. Karsy has graciously agreed to send them out. And as always, thank you all for joining. Please have a happy and healthy month. We will be back in the second week of July with a talk from Dr. G. Kim, our new radiation oncologist from City of Hope, who will be talking about concepts, novel concepts in radiation therapy in neuroscience. Thank you all, and have a good week. Take care. Bye, everyone.